Hi everyone, and good evening, and welcome to this evening session. I trust all of you are keeping well, and I think in some ways, as the weather's warming up, I think we're all feeling a lot more chirpy and cheery. This evening, I think we've had so many Zoom talks, and the idea for this evening really was that to have a space where we could have a conversation rather than a talk. And I think for many of us, we've been going through various experiences. It's been a very rich time for insight and reflection and things like that. So I think it would be a nice opportunity for us just to tap into some of the learnings that we've had, and also many times when we hear the lessons and the learnings of others, it resonates for us, and it sometimes crystallizes things for us in a deeper way. So that's the aim of this evening, really, just to explore a little bit from the heart and discover things and affirm things that we've been discovering and learning and experiencing. So I wanted to invite you all today. I think of this evening as not that you're sitting in a hall or anything of that sort, but I want you to think of yourself as being in a space where it's comfortable. Think of yourself maybe in your lounge or wherever. You have a cup of tea or hot chocolate or whatever you'd like. And just imagine this evening as a group of friends that are together. And as we are together, we just having a chat together. Sorry, someone just asking me. Okay, someone just saying that because of rainy weather, the connection may not be too stable. No problem, just come in and out as you can. So let's just start. Firstly, I would just like to invite all of you into a little moment of just centering ourselves as we try to get logged on and all sorts of things that happen in our day. So just close your eyes for a moment and taking a deep breath. And as you breathe in, just allow yourself to take in this feeling of quietness and calmness and stillness. Just taking in clean air, fresh air. And as you're breathing out, just releasing and letting go. Just allowing yourself to just relax totally. So there may be thoughts of your day buzzing around in your mind. And just let it subside with each breath, just breathe it out and just come back to a place of just being quiet and still. And as you allow yourself to relax, you just find a quiet spot within your being. And that at the core of one's being, this peace. And just inviting you to come back into that place of peace, into that place of just feeling centered and anchored. Just being in the moment, enjoying the here and the now. Just enjoying the space of being together. Okay. Thank you. So I want to welcome all of you, and specifically I want to welcome a dear friend, Bonini, who I had invited to be part of this conversation today. So Bonini, I'd like you to say hello, and if you'd like to just introduce yourself a little bit.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for your patience.
Hi, you're a bit soft, Bonini.
I'm saying hello, everybody, and thank you for your patience. I was being challenged by the technology. Can everybody hear me?
We can hear you. You're good. Don't worry. We just started, so it's okay. I'm good.
Oh. Great. So I have known, or I've been with Brahma Kumaris now, I think, for almost 4 years. And I was introduced to BH by my Qigong teacher, Michelle, who is a Brahma Kumaris follower herself. And at the time when I joined, or I became part of this community, I was going through my own Asias, or trying to understand life from a totally different perspective. I'm born and bred in the city, and not that where I'm born has anything to do with how I came into an understanding life and living life from the platform that I'm living from right now. And the platform is not anything amazing or holy, but it's just understanding life from an inside out point of view. And I guess that's why maybe Sr Pratiba found it fitting to invite me to this talk, So a couple of years ago, I found myself contemplating life by asking myself a particular type of question. And the one question that stood out for me that was really painful at the time when I was asking myself that question was, who am I? A question that's often in our conditioning and in our grooming of who we are in formulating our identity. Who we are is based on where you come from, who your parents are, what number in the line of siblings you are in, what are your qualifications and what you have, and so on. And this question pushed me to really try and understand myself beyond the material things that have been associated with me. And I often describe it as a place or space that I was in that made me to go onto my knees, in the literal sense, not only from a praying perspective, but I found myself having to bow down to it and really surrender and go in. Almost felt like oftentimes I wanted to curl in and literally just go in, to a point where I used to have this imagery of wanting to go into a cave where I can go in and just sit in there and just really try and understand this person that I am. It really allowed me to strip off all the conditioned layers of who I am, that I have somehow gotten to a point where I couldn't relate to those things. And that's how I got into this inner work process. It wasn't because it was the instinct to do all of a sudden, but because I found myself very much in need of understanding who am I. But having said that, can I really answer that question today and do justice to it? Probably not, but I'm probably better at it now than I was 5 years ago. And 5 years ago is when I started this company called Bonini Inc. So Bonini Inc, the INC stands for Bonini Incorporated, because I wanted to incorporate all the personalities that I have at the time, all 500 of them, and those that I'm still yet to meet. And once I got to that point where I allowed myself to embrace all of me, all of my flaws, all of my cavities, all of my jarring and big character and personality, and also the part of me that really want to go into solitude moments but didn't know how at the time, and equally so the part of me that put a gentle smile on my face that I dream about, I wonder about, I'm still wondering, I'm still very much curious and wondering what's next. So who am I is now not so much about what I have in my bank account, the type of car that I drive, or the clothes that I wear, or the profession that I serve. However, it is about embracing this thing called life. I think I can really now own it when I say I am a spirit. And that's who I am. Why are you rude? I can't hear you.
Hi, great, thank you. So yeah, I think in some ways, all of us that are here have been in some form or another on this journey of really getting to know who I am and what I am. And also the feeling really is that how this time with COVID in a way put life on pause. I like using this analogy of the pause button, because as life came on to pause, we had no choice but actually to look inside, and I think in some ways we've known many things about our spiritual nature, perhaps as theory. But I think in this time where sort of the normal rhythm of life came to a halt and we had to step back, it made us begin to question and look deeper in a sense to say, okay, what I've known and what I've studied and what I've explored, how real is it in my consciousness and how real is it in terms of my own personal experience? So for this evening, because we want to create it as a space of conversation, if you're comfortable, we would like you to switch on your cameras if you can, so that we have this as a conversation and not so much as a talk. I wanted to just start off this evening and, you know, just exploring between us in a way, firstly, what we felt has been some of the key learnings that the last few months offered us as a gift. I think one thing is that everything that we experience depends a lot on the way we look at it. And when we look at these last few months, not as a crisis, though it was in some ways on some level, but if we look at it as a gift, then we can actually draw out and see that there is a big plan at play that is helping us to return to, I think, certain aspects within ourselves and certain levels in our consciousness to make it real, to make it stable, to make it authentic in ourselves, to deepen a sense of awareness within ourselves and experience, so that what may come in the future, whatever that may be, it's like this time has helped us to create something really solid in ourselves. I was just sharing with the group during my recent trip in Cape Town that I felt that this time has been an incubation time. And, you know, it's like an analogy that came to me in one of my meditations just recently was like, you have a seed and you need to, and you put that seed underground, and, you know, the seed absorbs the water and it absorbs the heat and whatever the case may be underground, and it sort of swells and grows. And then there comes a point when the outer skin of the seed cracks open. And when that happens, then suddenly the roots can come out and the stem comes out, and that seed grows into something. And there's then a birthing of it that breaks through the ground, breaks through the soil, and it becomes visible. So this time of incubation is the time where the work that needs to be done and the work that is being done is like invisible work. It's underneath the surface. It's happening in our consciousness and more so in our hearts, you know? And so it's preparing us. It's preparing us so that when the time is, we need to step out, and that we step out with confidence, that we step out with real power, that we step out with a wider awareness, that we step out with compassion. And so that has been my general overall feeling of what this time has meant. It's a time of deep preparation and incubation, and you know, even the idea that, you know, how just before winter, how the leaves go yellow and red, and then in winter they fall off completely. So it's like stripping away the form. And it is a quieter time, but then out of that, it releases new life and gives birth to something new. So that's how I've been looking at this time, as an incubation time, a preparation time, as a time to allow for something really powerful to happen within, so that when the time's ready, we can step out. Bonini, what has this time meant for you?
It has meant quite a lot of things, and beyond or within the philosophical structure that you have just presented, which is absolutely amazing, and I love the analogy of the seed. It allowed me, in particular, to understand what matters. What matters in terms of what I need to devote my time and give my time, energy, and attention to. Because it really, really streamlined and showed you what is available for you and what is accessible. Because I think oftentimes when we are busy, we force ourselves into things. We force ourselves into situations because we think it has to be done, because we think everybody's doing that. So because of the fact that it allows us to really be alone, some people had to be alone. And even in the space of togetherness and being in each other's faces, it really pulled through that sense of stillness. Where one had to understand that if I am not comfortable in my own moments of solitude, then it means I'm keeping bad company, and that bad company is yourself. And it also allowed me to really appreciate, and I don't even think appreciate really tapped into the extent of how appreciative I was of that time, because it allowed me to realize how prepared I was for it. It sounds weird because I'm a mortal, I'm breathing like everybody else, and I'm talking the opposite of what other billion of people are saying. I was the most excited human being on earth when lockdown started. And mainly because I was enjoying my own company as Bonini. As you said, if you have done your own inner work, whatever happens on the external world should not really affect you that much. You need to start understanding what are the germs, what are the nuggets, what is this communicating? It really allowed me to really now come out and be still and observe, which is something that I know Brahma Kumaris, you love saying, which is observing. And by observing, I had to see what is needed, what is happening, without forcing myself into situations. You know, often in business, you think, oh, I need to go and knock on this door. I need to go. Whereas when you observe, you get to see, oh, this is what is happening. Oh, this is what I can do. So I found myself very much operating from my strength versus my weaknesses. And I'll make one silly example, because I think right now people think we have come up with some amazing ideas. Let's take the issue of just preparing meals for family. I love cooking, and particular types of meals. I love cooking your dinner and your lunches, breakfast not so much. And I found myself really wanting to make it even more wholesome than before. Not because I was forced to, but it felt, I felt drawn into that because I already had that gift of cooking. So going into it, I had the time, I had the energy, I had the attention for it. So it really was, one of my best meals actually were cooked around that time. And I enjoyed because I moved into that space from my place of strength. That's what I mean. Because I observed and I saw that, oh, I have this available to me, which is maybe, yes, in my case, I had resources to buy, you know, the ingredients that I need to try some of the meals. So that's what I mean, because I needed to do an introspection and say, oh, what can I do in this time? And I really enjoyed it. And it'd be lovely to hear what other people have to say about that, because I think it was different for all of us in different ways. What is everybody's take on that?
An invitation. If any of you would like to share, please feel free, unmute yourself. Or if you would like to also, you can write on the chat if you're not too comfortable to unmute yourself. One element that I found which was fascinating for me, or that just unfolded in a very lovely and natural way, and that was just right at the beginning of lockdown. I think it was actually just a few days, right at the beginning of lockdown. It was like there was an inspiration to embark on a little project of bringing together voices from all over the world into a program which we, you know, call the 21 Masterclass Series. And why it felt like such a wonderful gift to be able to be embarking on such a program was, I think what has happened in the last 6 months is it's twofold. On one level, for the first time, we are experiencing something globally. It's not by region or by part of the world, but it's every country and everyone. And in some ways, it spoke to me in two ways. One is that we are all vulnerable. You know, sometimes we think as people and as human beings, you know, we can be above everything. But this has taught us, no, we are very much part of the ecosystem on this planet, and that there is a certain level of vulnerability as well. But also that, you know, borders are so artificial. And this pandemic has just reflected that borders are just so artificial. They're not, they're in our minds, but they're not real in a sense. And so on one level, we're seeing a physical representation of that. But I think it also made me realize that it's also on another level that what we can do and what we are capable of and how we can contribute is beyond borders as well. So many times we've tended to keep such a limited sense of what we can offer, what we can do, how we can contribute, how we can connect. And we've confined ourselves in these little boxes, you know, whether it's the box of gender or the box of nationality or the box of education or whatever the case may be. And suddenly it just opened up this kind of a window to say, you can be what you want to be. You can share what you want to share. You can really express and be a contributor and extend yourself beyond the so-called artificial boundaries and borders that we've been conditioned into thinking that we are and that we need to operate within. So it gave such a feeling of expansiveness, you know, in that way. And also a deep sense of connectedness. I think one aspect that really was lovely for me was just that I worked with the team from different countries completely. There was Moni from Australia and from Turkey and Spain and Italy. And so it was just such a lovely combination of talents and contribution, but also that my friends are beyond borders, you know, and I think that sense of connectedness that we're never alone, you know. That physically, yes, physical spaces may demarcate things, but at the level of spirit, at the level of love, at the level of connectedness and connectivity, we're never alone. And so the support, the insights, the sense of friendship expanded and made me realize the fortune of being able to connect on such a wide level. So that was a lovely gift as well, you know, just a sense that at the physical level, what was happening was opening up another level of opportunity and another level of a way of being and living that perhaps was there, but we never really explored it before. Yeah.
Absolutely. Anybody else who experienced that connectivity within the nucleus cycle or within the bigger part, which is the ecosystem being the global space?
Yeah. Good evening. Sorry, may I just share a thought that I had for this pandemic, calling from Durban. It felt as if the whole world was at a giant robot at the same time. And everybody was at the red stop sign. And when that happened, then the nature, the outside elements had a chance to actually heal themselves. All the resources had a chance to heal themselves because people were not now abusing it, if I may use that word, or taking it for granted. So nature really had a time to heal itself, because later, as the pandemic went on, there was a lot of greenery. There was a lot of freshness on the outside. It was almost as if outside was new, although we were inside. Then the second thing that happened was that at the beginning of this pandemic, it was a very exciting time. There was no time to be afraid for anything or just be cautious, be at home and get stuck into the things that we said we didn't have time to do. We'll do it one day. So what happened is we started experimenting with newness in the way of physical, material, cooking, you know, things for the body, tidying the house, putting things here, putting things there. And I think a lot of people actually felt the exhilaration of the freedom of time that was accorded to them. So there wasn't that, on a subtle level, there would have been perhaps a collective fear from those that didn't understand too much, perhaps the unknown. You know, there's always the fear of the unknown. But as time went by, and things started changing and people started getting cabin fever, the world was now at a yellow light at the robot. So some moved cautiously ahead and others kind of stayed on the sidelines, hovering over the red and the yellow robots. And nothing seemed quite the same again. That excitement of that additional time was almost finished, if you may call it that, because how much can you clean your cupboards and your clothes, you know? How much new things can you cook? Okay, maybe there's something there. All right. But there was a newness, there was a new wave of creativity that started by many, many, many people. Mm. For me personally, the newness was on all this technology. I mean, gee, right at the beginning, it was, it's nice. But no, what if I, you know, sort of stuff it up, make a mistake, and then, you know, I'll do the wrong thing. No. And then the cost factor came in because of the unknown. I didn't know whether this technology was going to cost me what my bill is going to look like. But then I settled into the excitement of knowing and being a part of a bigger picture of technology. That was great. Then when the green light, well, we almost on a green light, it's flickering, and the world is at the space of a green light, people don't know what to do going forward. So they pretend that everything is normal, but there is nothing that is normal anymore. Because in the beginning, you used to see the negative element wearing masks and you know, involved in crime. Now the mask is mandatory. And if you don't know people, if you haven't seen people for long, you don't actually have this recognition of people. So for me personally, it's a time of separating the self, of going into my own isolation, but without being isolated from people. It was going into my own mind and finding the space that I had to fill with new things, with, you know, not challenged in any way because of that. So I personally said right at the beginning, thank you to this world, dunya and the Hindi word, you know, and we asked forgiveness to the world for the misuse of everything that happened. And it took this huge, big pandemic to show the world how we can unite without being together. So there's still a lot of hope for every soul to still come together and still maintain their social distance. So I love this COVID time. I really do. Okay, there is the care for all those who are no longer around. It had played its part. It took its toll. But personally, I celebrated the exquisite, extraordinary beauty.
Great, thank you. I see there's been a few comments that have come to, and that is thanks to technology bringing us so close more than ever before. Also upgraded my skills in technology. That was from Indrani, and Sherry has shared great stuff, dear, your analogy. And then Isadora has shared, I'm loving this time spending with these lovely souls. I echo Indrani's sentiments as well. So yeah, I think in some ways it has offered us an opportunity to learn new things and to explore and extend ourselves beyond what we thought we were capable of. So that's been a lovely learning for all of us. Yeah. Good.
I love Priscilla's perception of how she literally found that the experience is so balanced. You know, how she saw the goodness of it, and equally she was very much honest in how, in the vulnerable parts of it, where it really affected her personally, which taps on what you said earlier about you're all vulnerable. and how she allowed herself to see. It's almost as if, if I were to draw an analogy, it's almost as if she was going in and out like a tortoise, you know, in and out. She can now, and this is how she says she gets to see a bigger picture, but also equally wants to go inward and understand it and synthesize it for herself, what it means. So I really think that it's so powerful, and it comes through so lovely that she really understood this from a very elevated place, where it was not just a personal thing, which I think a lot of people took it from that perspective, where it has become such a personal trauma. Yes, granted, in certain cases, people have lost their jobs. I fully understand that. But it's also important to understand, what did it connect you with inwardly that you had never experienced before?
There's a lovely comment here by Isadora, who's saying that, in fact, we are crossing borders and becoming more united. I am in Mozambique. Yeah, it's great, yeah, that, you know, borders which are artificial don't matter anymore, and that our connection can happen through that. One thing that Priscilla touched on, and I think it's become sort of a buzzword now, and that is that we all recognize and understand that we can't go back to business as usual. I think sometimes we wanting to do that. It's like, okay, we've been there, done that. It's all over now. Let's get back to where we were at. I think this has been a defining moment, in a sense, for us as a global family, as humanity as a whole. And so the question really is, in a way, that so how do I move on from here? You know, so, you know, I use the analogy of it being an incubation time, but now we are sort of coming out and stepping out from beneath the surface of that soil. So the question, you know, that in my mind is really that, okay, how do I move from here going forward? And what is it that I need to watch myself on in a very loving way, that I don't spiral back to old patterns? Because, you know, sometimes how old patterns can have sort of a pull on one when everything seems normal, in that sense. And so moving forward, what's new as I move forward? What is of significance as I'm taking the next steps forward? So that is a question that's playing in my mind. So I'm going to invite if anyone else has any questions, in terms of, like, now we've had this experience, we've been through this, how do we see ourselves moving forward?
May I just say something with regards to my experience in terms of humanity and where we are? For me, it was, you know, they say God throws a pebble on your head and you don't acknowledge it, and then he throws a rock, and then eventually he throws the boulder on your head. For me, it's a reckoning of mankind, and it was a leveler of sort. Race, religion, creed, wealth, absolutely nothing mattered. Every human being was put at one single level. And then it gave us time for introspection, and also think about what we do to nature. And during this time, we were locked up in cages and nature was thriving. And normally we lock the animals in cages and we look at them. And as you know, in many places, even places like Venice, that the water changed color. There were animals roaming around in places in suburban streets and things like that. So for humanity, it is a spreading. And it took this much, like sort of a Holocaust, to bring people to realize that we all laugh and cry for the exact same thing. So we need to see what is important now. What is important? Or this time should have told us what is important. Is it all the accumulation of all the things? We didn't need much when we were home. We didn't need all the makeup we have, the clothing, the shoes, and everything that we strive for, bags. And it didn't matter. You had to hold your bag in your hand and throw it one side and walk up and down the stairs or do something to entertain yourself, you know? So for me, at this point, we should have thought, what is the way forward? What is important now? That would be the question for me. Thank you.
Yes, definitely made us think about our priorities and what is it that we give value to. And sometimes intellectually we say these are the things I give value to, but how much of my time am I willing to invest in the things that I say are valuable to me? So it did give us time for that. Sue has put a lovely comment on that. I notice I'm much slower and more mindful in everything I do. That's lovely. And then Emma said, Om Shanti, this time has helped me to grow spiritually. Total gratitude to the Brahma Kumaris. Yeah. So yeah, deep learnings and also a different way of being. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Good evening. I'd just like to share my experience in a very simple way where I really took care of myself internally, really creating this internal environment for myself where just letting go of all the old feelings and hurried feelings, needing to do this and needing to do that and needing to do things for others. But for a change, I allowed myself to really nurture the self, nurture the mind, and nurture the feelings. And the more I did this, the more love and care started to emerge, because when I started to work on myself at this time, in this quiet space, it was very, very peaceful. And when I was in my peaceful space, I was able to think less, but think more on a positive level. And also, because I nurtured myself, I was able to use my mind in a very powerful way to actually send out good thoughts to souls who were experiencing the hardship. They were experiencing so much of sorrow so that I couldn't get there. But with my mind, I realized I could actually send out powerful, nurturing thoughts to them as well. So I realized how much I had to also work on myself as an individual. Thank you.
Thank
you. Good evening.
Go ahead, Emma.
Hi, good evening. Yes, this time has indeed taught me that I also need to keep a check on my thoughts. Because my thoughts, my impure thoughts, are also polluting our beautiful world. So I need to make sure that my every thought is pure, kind, and gentle to myself and to every other soul out there. And yes, I found it also a time where I'm praying a lot more for others as well. And it also brings me a lot of peace. So yes, let's all be in peace together and heal our world. Thank you.
Thank you. It's lovely to see the connection for many that are sharing in a way that as we learn to take care of ourselves and be kinder to ourselves, how very naturally the capacity emerges and not just aim, but this kind of compassion for others naturally emerges, you know? It's like only, it's our ability to give can only really be there when we learn to give to ourselves first. And perhaps our conditioning before this was that to give to ourselves, we thought of it as being selfish. But maybe this time is teaching us that to give to the self and nurture the self is the way to give to others. It grows your capacity to serve at a wider level. So that's been lovely to see coming through from people. Yeah.
I would like us to take further the question that Sherry left us with, which is, what is important now? Mm-hmm. And I'm pretty sure that question, she's not necessarily directing it to all of us, but it's one of the questions that she's also asking herself. And that's one of the things that really came through for me, the quality of questions that I was asking myself. What kind of questions did you find yourself going through, or you're still going through, or still asking about the loss of you?
There's a comment in the chat that I'd like to just read out while we're waiting for someone to respond to that. It's from Carol. I died during lockdown. I feel like someone who has viewed their life from the other side. I have come back to see everyone else as another me. I don't sweat the small stuff anymore. Great. Very powerfully put. Coming out from the other end, yeah. Anyone else would like to share?
Okay. Golden. There's another comment from Emma. Do you want to read that one, sister?
Yeah, sure. Going forward, amongst other things, is to be kinder and more compassionate. Forgive and forget. God bless. Yeah, I think one thing that that became such a realization or an insight for people, or just became so evident, that how we separate ourselves, or how we deny ourselves good and positive experiences because of little things, you know, how little things we had allowed to become something so big that we actually in some ways allowed it to affect our relationships. And I think this time has taught us that, you know, just to be more understanding, compassionate, and tolerant of the little things. And in some ways, you know, acceptance of myself, acceptance of each other, acceptance of time, and where we find ourselves. And that I think one thing that really does help when we hold that awareness is that the universe and really life and our relationship with God as well, is that there will always be some positive outcome at the end of the day. It's, life is benevolent in a way. And I think for me, that has always been something that always helped to pull through, that no matter what the current experience is, there is a benevolence in this moment that is being offered. And if I just step back and see it, then I can let it carry me through. Yeah.
Thank How do we steer it, Kristen? How do we do that?
Sorry, you're not too clear there, Bonini. What did you say?
How do we steer it? How do we connect with that kindness, that benevolence?
I think, you know, for each one of us, it is a process of discovering what works for us. But to me, there's always two things that play an important role. One is learning to look at myself with kindness. If I may just say in some ways that when we made the material things or the physical things or the small stuff become so important, it was like we were operating from the ego. And the ego always, when we're operating from that space, it's always judgment. And I think we hold the greatest judgment towards ourselves, never mind towards anyone else. And that is what always separates me from this natural, innate core of love that I am. So the first step is really, looking at myself and like watching my mind, my internal conversations in my mind, watching my attitude in myself and really turning it, you know, consciously turning it to be more loving and accepting to the self. Even when I felt maybe angry about something, or even when I felt sad about something, because I think we all went through those emotions as well. It's not that we were all very happy all the time, but you know, we had to work through things. So even at times when I did feel weak, or when I did feel sad, or when I did feel angry, it was almost like seeing that and not being judgmental for holding that emotion, but seeing it with kindness and seeing it that it is something that I perhaps had trapped in myself before, or I haven't resolved. And so it is only with that feeling of kindness towards the self that one actually finds the strength to work through it and resolve it. And even if everything is not resolved, but to feel I understand myself better from that experience and that emotion. So for me, that's the first aspect of really learning to see the self with more kindness and acceptance and love. And the second aspect is also that I think, you know, the awareness that we all have a connection with the Supreme Soul, with God. And somehow, you know, in the busyness of achieving stuff in our lives, we push God aside to maybe the Sunday bit that I do, or, you know, we never integrated the relationship of God in terms of my own sense of who I am. And so for me, this time also gave a space to begin to, you know, deeply look at how I connect with God. What is that relationship? How real is that relationship? And how intimate is that relationship? But has it moved from a place of philosophy, ideology, concept to a place of being able to draw from that relationship the experience of love? And so in one way, as one begins to feel that love, which is a very pure love and subtle, that experience of love is what naturally awakens the kindness in me. I don't have to think about being kind, but when I do feel loved deeply, it's almost like I naturally will respond with kindness and compassion. So that has been a bit of my exploration with regards to that. Yeah. Bonini, it's already an hour. So I'm going to ask you to share your last comment or so, and then we'll end up with the meditation. Would you like to
share your comment? There's a couple of comments on, sister.
Okay, we have Ahista who said, BK has been a constant support during lockdown. Learning was fast-paced thanks to these many, many sessions we had together. And Carol is asking, it would be good to hear a brother's experience. Hema's just saying that, to all my brothers and sisters, stay strong and know that you are protected. Every visitor has to leave eventually, and this thing too will pass. And then Carol is sharing one more point, is that we have gone through the chrysalis experience. It's impossible to go back to be the caterpillar. We have transformed into beautiful, gentle beings. Okay. Great, thank you. Okay. Would you like to share your last comment, and then I'll end off with the meditation? Thanks.
Oh, right. I really love some of the questions that you posed earlier. How do we move on from here? And I think to a certain extent, you've already answered that. And equally so, the touch on the question that Sherry left us with, what is important. And for me, where to from here is, It literally expresses itself through my body. As I'm saying those words, there are particular parts of my anatomy that have just moved. The first part being my shoulder and the front part of my chest. A surrender. Just to float. Just to allow the world to be as it is, because we often want to think that when bad things happen, God is not involved. This is still God's will. For us to have mountains, something had to happen that was uncomfortable. For us to have houses that we're in, nature had to be disturbed. There are so many things that go through discomfort that we are not aware of, and yet because we are so privileged to see that some of us for the first time in our life, we think, it has to end. Indeed, it will come to an end, but it is what it is. This is where we are. And if we could allow ourselves to just observe it, and just see what it is presenting, what if there's a diamond somewhere inside? And you're busy saying, let it end. So it's so important for us to really practice what we have all shared this evening with the thing. It allowed me to go in and go in and see what this is communicating to you on a deeper level. And one of the things that I have been doing a lot of on my own, but also with my clients, is breathing. Breath is the language of life. The breath always communicates what you're going through. Stop there. Start noticing, how are you breathing now? Are you breathing fully? Are you really embracing life, or are you waiting to embrace life when COVID stops? Because that means your life stops even regardless of COVID. For some of us, we have associated the death of our life or the disruption to COVID. Yet, it was already flawed, and we never really realized. What next is for us to really, really, really fall madly in love with ourselves. Like Sister Patila said, to love love. When the ride is high, go up, be a surfer, enjoy it. And when it's down, let's just observe it and be there and bask in the sun. That is life. It's a wave. If it was to be steady and just be a constant wave, it would be really boring. That's why we're all different cultures. We're on the part of doing inner work. Inner work doesn't stop. Inner work is how you get to grow and how you get to connect with these amazing things that you have shared this evening on a continuous basis. It's really unpacking. It's applying yourself from the inside out to the to life and not allowing life to dictate who you are and how you should conduct it.
I can't hear you too clearly. You're sort of going a bit too soft.
Oh, thank you to everybody who joined us this evening. It's been really, really wonderful for you to commit your time and energy and attention to join us this evening. And thank you, BK, for really inviting me. So, on that note, I'm sharing.
Great, thank you. Yes, a big thank you to all of you for joining in this evening and participating. I think it was really nice to hear your input and have that sense that we all growing together and learning together. And this space of sharing is what I think affirms us and also makes us realize that how connected we are, how we sort of grow as a wave. I always feel that we grow as a wave and we're getting to where we need to get to as a community. So thank you very much. So we'll end off with a short meditation, which I'll lead you into. Thank you. So just sit comfortably upright. And in this moment, just allow yourself to settle in yourself. And return to that sweet space in your being of the sacred light that you are. As you reconnect that energy of light that you are, give yourself the permission to really feel stillness, to really feel the fullness of your being, to feel the joy. Like a beautiful diamond shining in you. Feel the expansion of your heart, the generosity, the compassion, the sweet kindness. And just give yourself this moment to step into and to feel and be the best of you, the sacred of who you are. And in this awareness, our deeper selves as consciousness. What I am is allow myself to step into being what I am. Very naturally, I feel a connectedness. We are all children of the one highest source of God. We are a creation of love. Like a beautiful bouquet of flowers, each unique, each special in their own way. We are this wonderful family of souls. Each unique, but each uniquely beautiful. And it is this beautiful energy of our togetherness, and that we held by love, and that we nurtured by the benevolent energy of God's presence. Allow this awareness and energy to be your breath, to be the very movement of your life, to be you. Om Shanti, thank you. Stay well, enjoy the rest of your day. And good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Take a ride with me to paradise. Heaven's in your heart beating inside. You're alive, the great divine, older than time. The miracle of you. and you are so beautiful. The way your body moves and holds it all. Your heart lights up hearts, and your whole love illuminates our world. Your soul is old. Your soul is old, and the stars in our sky, billion year old lights light up the sky, and you can feel the universe through your heart, the divine design of you. The time has come for you to honor the miracle of you. All the road's been long, and the heart is strong. Let your love lift you up. Let your heart rocket you to honor the mirror.